Day off right with today.
It is. Took them back out the Beast Sway in the morning, Shade 4-5. Want to start your day off right? We always give applause in the beginning of the show where we count all our blessings. Let's do it again, man. It's a beautiful Monday. Coming off a great weekend. We had a great party at Hooters Saturday night.
We like to party.
Yes, indeed. We party with a purpose, Heather B.
We party with a purpose. This past Saturday, we raised money for Hope Lodge. It's a foundation that gives residency to people who have to come to New York City to receive chemotherapy that can't afford it. Yeah, so it's an amazing. And we raised so much money. It was awesome. And we just watched the game and we drank a lot.
Yeah. But we raised money.
We raised money.
That was the purpose.
We party, but with a purpose.
With a purpose. Man, up next, man, we got a young man who's always had a purpose when it comes to his pen, Heather B.
That's right.
One of the things I like about him is he's a well-rounded singer, songwriter, entertainer, performer, just all-around great guy. I feel like I know him really well just through his music. He's penned a lot of great hits for the artists such as overseas artist J.P. Cooper. They had a lot of success with their work, but Duran, Jay-Z, he's known for his work with 808s and Heartbreaks. He's back again with an album. It's been a long time. We're going to hear it celebrated today and see what it's all about when the machine stops, ladies and gentlemen. I'm going to open up the phone lines right now so we can get to talking to him, the one and only Mr. Hudson. Mr. Hudson is here.
But you know what? With all of that, I've never been to Hooters.
You never been to Hooters?
Oh, my.
Damn, you say it's so...
Apparently, they have very good wings.
But the shrimp.
I'm more of a shrimp man than a wing man.
They have shrimp, right, Tracy? Yep. Fried pickles.
Okay.
Crab legs, oysters.
Great, let's go.
A lot of good stuff.
That's lunch sorted.
Fried pickles. You're from across the pond, right?
Yeah.
Birmingham or?
Birmingham, England, yeah. Home of the Peaky Blinders.
Okay, what's the dialect there? Is it different from?
We've got several. I mean, we're called Brummies.
Okay.
You know, and you probably wouldn't understand what I was saying if I spoke in a thick Brummie accent.
Well, it's the King's English, right?
No, it's a place to itself. I mean, the King's or Queen's English is more down south. It's more like how people, you know, how the Queen sounds.
Okay, so give me an example. Maybe let's see. Say something you think we wouldn't understand,
right.
And as a collective, we're going to deliberate and see what it is you said.
Well, okay. All right, Sway, how's it going, mate? How's New York these days?
Okay.
You said, what up, my dog? How's it going, man?
New York
popping right now?
Say your name.
No, I mean, you know, okay, okay, I got Sway. That, right? You know, how's New York? Okay, give me something else.
I've never been to Hooters. I've heard they've got incredible wings.
Incredible.
It's a different accent.
See,
I would
have had that accent as a kid, and then the further I moved south, I think it just kind of, you know,
drifted.
People couldn't understand what I was saying, probably.
So people try to have your accent. Do you try to have like a New York accent? Do you have a good New York accent?
I couldn't do one, and particularly I'm not going to try it on air, you know.
You never
But listen, okay. On the subject of Birmingham, it's not only the home of the Peaky Blinders, which I'm sure you've seen and enjoyed. It's a great show. It's the home of the Industrial Revolution. It's also the home of Duran Duran.
There we go.
There's some great music out of Birmingham. Steel Pulse.
Steel Pulse.
For any reggae fans out there.
Yeah.
Okay.
The Streets. You know The Streets?
I don't know.
You need to get familiar.
Okay.
Original Pirate Materials, his first album. It changed the game in the UK.
Okay.
That's an important record.
The Streets.
The Streets.
The Streets.
Okay. Original. Okay.
Get familiar.
Mm-hmm. The Streets. Wait, The Streets or The Straits?
The Streets, mate.
Spell it.
Like Streets.
Streets like blocks. Streets.
We haven't got time to spell Streets.
Okay, all right. Cool.
Too many E's in the middle.
There's a lot of E's, right? Okay, see, it's interesting, Heather, because I remember doing the EMA's red carpet over in Europe, and Duran had the Paper Gods project that they were putting out, and they were just celebrating, you know, they couldn't wait to tell me they worked with Mr. Hudson, and I was like, I couldn't, for the love of mankind, I thought it was a great, you know, collaborative effort. But I was like, well, how did that come together? So you guys are from the same place.
They wouldn't have let me in the studio if I hadn't been from Birmingham.
Really?
Oh, wow.
So they called Mark Ronson and said, Mark, we need to do another record with you. He said, look, I'm busy. I'm working on a record. It became Uptown Funk and everything. But he said, you need to speak to this to my friend Ben. He can help you out. He can make some music with you. So I went in for like, you know, I tried to book a couple of days with them. They would thought, well, you know, we'll maybe give him a try. But maybe the whole band weren't convinced or whatever, but then when their manager said he's from Birmingham, they said, oh, just send him over.
Oh my God.
Wow.
That was a permission slip.
Isn't it funny how like just somebody being from the same place just reassures you somehow.
Mm-hmm. He acts like that every day. To people from Oakland, California. Have you heard of it?
I have, yeah. You know, I live in California at the minute.
No.
Yeah.
What part?
Los Angeles. It's a city. It's quite near the ocean.
Okay. Yeah, I've heard of it.
Yeah. Good music coming out of LA.
Yeah, out of LA?
Over the years, yeah.
Yeah. Shout out to Quincy White. He's from LA.
Yes.
All right. Mm-hmm. You should be working with him, too, by the way. I'm just going to throw that out.
Quincy White.
Remember that name.
Okay.
So that's how the Duran. Did you get the least bit intimidated by who they are, their presence?
Absolutely. Yeah. I always get starstruck when I meet, you know, stars. And to be honest, I get starstruck by... you know, all the time.
Oh, wow.
They don't necessarily have to be a huge star. I'm just like, if I've heard your work first, if I've heard your music, that's special. So then to meet the human, you know, it's almost like a first date or something.
Yeah,
you
I
know?
Was about to say, how do you define starstruck? How does that manifest for you? Like,
just being put off and like not being on your normal like Monday morning swag of like, I've got my coffee, I've got my apple, I know what I'm doing, you know, Jason Bourne vibes. And but you know, I rocked up at the studio. This is Duran. Simon Le Bon, legend, okay, turns up on his motorcycle and I'm just there, you know, I just got the train, I'm just like, got my laptop. He turns up on his motorcycle, the fans are waiting outside the studio. He lifts the motorcycle helmet off, he's signing some autographs. He's like, hey, you must be Ben. I'm like, yes. And I've worked with some big people. You know, I've broken bread with some big people.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I've performed with and for and blah blah blah, and I've, you know, I've been in the studio with some big people, but every time I meet someone who's a legend, I'm like, you're a legend.
Wow.
You tell them.
And I'm a boy from Birmingham. So to me it's, you know, I explain to when I'm, you know, in other places, I say, like, say I'm in the States, I say, look, it's like being from Cleveland, and then you're in New York or LA, and you're working with these big people. Mm-hmm. You're gonna be like, wow, I'm here, I made it.
Yeah, because you still have that inner child that's like, I remember how much you influenced me when I was like 7.
Yeah, and it's called imposter syndrome, isn't it? You're like,
that too.
Am I really like? You could kind of look around as surely someone else is meant to be doing this, but then you have to say, hang on, yeah, I have made a few records. I do know what I'm doing. Okay, the red button, let's go.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
when you met, because you did Forever Young with Jay.
That's right.
And who, when you first met him, how did that happen?
We made the record before we met. Yeah.
Really? Let's take a listen to this for a second.
Sounds familiar.
Yeah.
Let's dance in style. Let's dance for a while. Heaven can wait. We're only watching the skies. Hoping for the best, but expecting the worst. Are you gonna drop the bomb or not? Let us die young or let us live forever. We don't have the power, but we never say never. Sitting in a sandpit, life is a short trip. The music's for the sad man. Forever young, I wanna be forever young. Do you really want to live forever?
It's hard not to sing along, isn't it?
Man, yo, bro, I sang that song 150 times easily. So y'all made it prior to even meeting in person?
Yeah, I was in Hawaii with Kanye and the Good Music guys, and I was out on the veranda. It was a Friday night. I'm sipping a Corona, and in my foolish youth, I think I might have even been posing with a cigarette, trying to impress a young Hawaiian lady. And I think Jeff Basker or somebody came out and was like, yo, Hudson, Kanye's got something he wants you to sing on. I was like, excuse me a moment.
in front of the ladies?
Put out the cigarette, which I wasn't inhaling because it's very unhealthy.
Yes.
And put down the beer. I said, I'll be back in a moment. I went indoors. I was like, what do you need, guys? And Jeff got on the keys and Kanye said, do you think you can sing this? And I was like, yeah, I mean, it's pretty high. It's pretty high. I went in the booth. I did a couple of takes, you know, just like, here's the mic, just like, oh, this is how it goes. While I was in the booth for about 10 minutes, because I had to learn the song and record it.
It's a cover, right? Alphaville?
Alphaville
from
absolutely.
1984.
Yeah, I'm not going to pretend it's mine.
Yeah. Well, I knew that.
And if I'd written it, there'd be a Bentley outside waiting for me.
Okay.
But
anyway. I like your storytelling.
So while I'm in the booth, so initially it was just me, Kanye, and Jeff, and Andrew Dawson, who did a wonderful job of engineering the whole record. midwifing the whole record. So he's at the board. So I went in and I'm just recording another day at the studio, right?
Yeah.
And I had to be on a plane the next morning to London. So I come out of the booth, and while I was in the booth, the rest of the squad all got back from the mall. Don C, Cuddy, Sean, they'd all been sneaker shopping. And there is no high quite like sneaker shopping for Americans, I've learned. Yeah. So they are high on life. They've got sneakers that they're like, these new joints with the thing. And I'm like, it all goes over my head. Right? Uh-huh. But they're pumped. A bottle of liquor comes out. I think T-Pain turns up with, is it Louis Trez on a cushion? You know
T-Pain
that brandy?
Yeah.
On a cushion.
Oh.
He had the brandy on a cushion.
In a flight case.
It had a dome throne. Okay. Wow.
So Cuddy's pouring that and mixing it with Dr. Pepper into like a red cup. I'm like, what's going on?
It's your memory, boy.
Are we the 13th with Dr. Pepper?
Anyway, so Cuddy comes up and gives me a hug and says, you know, you just dismantled the booth there. You crushed it. All of these words. And
Kid,
I'm like,
Cuddy told you this.
That's the first person I spoke to when I came out of the booth, having done Forever Young. I didn't realize what I'd done.
Yeah.
We didn't realize what we'd done. But we played it back on the big speakers at that impossible volume that can only be achieved in a hip-hop session.
Absolutely.
I put earplugs in and then headphones over the earplugs.
Oh,
that's survival. Anyway, it turned into a party. We're celebrating. You know those songs you celebrate before they've even left the studio because you just know, you know it's special. Mm-hmm. We didn't know what was going to happen to it. We just knew we had this incredible keyboard sound and this vocal, and it was just, and Ye's drums, thanks to playing Pat, like feeding the drums into the MPC.
Uh-huh.
We knew we had something, so it turned into a party. Mm. By 2 o'clock in the morning, we're in the club.
Oh.
And I'm there, Amili. I'm thick like Nigerian hair. You know, I'm like, I've got to be at the airport at like 6 a.m.
Oh my.
That's
and you in the club.
I'm in the club. We're still celebrating this song.
The same
what
song.
Did you leave?
I don't know. I went to the airport. Okay. I got on the plane back to New York. And I turned my BlackBerry on when I get.
My BlackBerry.
It's 2009. Yeah. I turned my BlackBerry on. It says, get on the plane back to LA. Jay loves the song. We need to do some more.
Did you know what they meant when they said Jay?
Yeah. Okay. So they'd sent the track to Jay. And he was like, perfect. Let's go. But I hadn't met Jay at that point. So he then wrote his verses. Right.
Mm-hmm. When did you first meet him?
We met on the set shooting the music video.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
I had strep throat. I should have been in bed. He knew it. So when I got to the set, he was like, you're a trooper. That's the first thing he said to me. You're a trooper. And he did the Jay-Z handshake, which is this.
Oh my
god!
Not
to catch no germs.
Because he didn't want to get my strep throat.
Do it again. Do it again. Let me see that. Oh, but you did get that little skin part right there, though.
Yeah.
He did that in the Rock Boys.
He didn't
want
to catch a. And did he say anything else to you other than you're a trooper?
I don't remember. I was like high on, you know, whatever drugs they give you when you've got strep throat.
Okay. All right. Wow.
Which we call tonsillitis back in the UK. Yeah, strep throat.
Strep throat, tonsillitis are the same things. Man, that's an amazing story, right? We heard Duran Duran. How did you and Kanye first meet?
Yes.
Like, what made that happen?
You know, I made a record with my band, The Library. So we were called Mr. Hudson and The Library, which doesn't look good on a poster, by the way.
Uh-huh.
And I mean, the first thing when I signed to Good Music, Ye was like, yeah, we're going to have to like consolidate that name down to just Mr. Hudson. Anyway, we made a record in London. And not that many people listened to it, but... crucially, Virgil Abloh listened to it.
Oh, wow.
Okay, this is 2006, 2007. And Virgil was, you know, he was working with Kanye on very early clothing stuff that became pastel.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And Virgil has always had eclectic taste. So he got hold of my album and... You know, which is not the kind of thing you'd normally expect to be like thrown down.
Which album was it? Wasn't like the Tale
of
Two
Cities. Tale of Two Cities.
You got
the knowledge.
All right.
So he must have played it to Kanye and said, "We got to sign this kid."
And that's how it happened. So
yeah,
Virgil,
simple.
Virgil was your A&R. Yeah. Your A&R rep.
You know, and he's, you know, I got a lot to thank him for, and he's doing so well, man. I'm just like.
Yeah, he's an incredible individual, man.
Yeah.
The energy, I would imagine, that you've experienced being around that good music network has to be different than what you ever experienced working on music.
It changed my life.
Yeah.
You know, and I also have Virgil to thank, because on that trip with the when we recorded Forever Young, that was like. That there were 2 seconds on the clock and I was at the halfway line because I hadn't contributed anything all week. They'd flown me out to Hawaii and I guess I was intimidated, or I just didn't know where do I fit? What's my position? Mm-hmm. I want to play my position, but I'm not a hip hop artist. I'm not a hip hop producer. I want to help. And I had contributed precisely zero.
Mm-hmm.
I'm in Hawaii in like an 11-star hotel.
Right.
Okay, there's dolphins in the pool. I'm like distracted.
Literally,
Google it.
Really?
Yes.
Wow.
So I'm distracted, right? There's fish. I've never had a fish taco in my life. They're delicious.
Oh, yes.
There's a pool with dolphins in it. I've got this 4-poster bed. The room opens out onto a golf course. I'm distracted. How am I supposed to work?
Yeah.
So the week has passed. I've been flown out at considerable expense, probably by Def Jam. Thank you, guys.
Uh-huh.
You know, I guess I'm gassed.
Yeah.
And I've contributed nothing. And it's Friday morning and I'm having breakfast with Virgil. And I said, and I think we, you know, the breakfast bar is like by the beach. So we're kind of wading out into the water. And we're literally the whitest and the blackest people in Hawaii at that point.
Yeah.
I'm like blue white. You know, Casper the ghost. So we're standing there in our shorts. Neither of us are swimmers. We're just standing there like, what do we do now? I'm like, Virgil, I'm burning. You know, Virgil's Ghanaian descent. He's fine.
Yeah.
He's like, okay, you're burning. Anyway, I said, Virgil, man, I feel bad. I haven't contributed anything. Mm-hmm. And he, with his typical wisdom, he said, you just got to get up to the plate. Just... you know, shoot your shots. I'm mixing my sporting metaphors here, but he's like, you just gotta step up to the plate.
Yeah.
And that's what I did that night with Forever Young.
You stepped
so
up.
So he was like, he was in my corner. He was my, you know, I'm now gonna use a boxing metaphor as well on top of baseball and basketball.
Good luck for her.
Yeah. It was American sports.
Yeah, man.
I have acclimatized.
Yeah, yes you are. Yes, you have, right?
He did. So Virgil pushed me up. He was like, go on, swing the bat. Go for it.
And you went for it.
Yeah, so thanks, Virgil, if you're listening.
Yeah, Mr. Hutchin is here. It's been a while since your last solo project, and now we're on the cusp of a new one, June 21st, right?
Yeah.
That's the release date of When the Machine Stops. You've been through so many different experiences, I would imagine. How did you approach this? Like, sound has changed.
You know, the
times have changed.
The music business has changed. Yeah. The way we make music, the way we distribute it, promote it, everything's mm-hmm. changed.
Uh-huh.
I mean, for me, there's some things that don't change, like the 808 kick drum
okay.
has not gone away.
Uh-huh.
You know, the kind of meat and potatoes of music haven't changed. Songs are shorter. That's something I've had to adjust to. It's like,
uh-huh.
forget the intro, forget the outro, forget the middle eight, the bridge, just like get straight to it.
Projects too are shorter.
Projects are shorter. Tierra Whack, you know, it's almost like kind of sport now. Like uh-huh. how short can your track be? And there's different ways of being impactful. For me, the challenge was, having worked in so many different genres with so many different people, how do I narrow it down to something that makes sense so that when I release a project, you're not getting like this weird kind of buffet thing. You know, when you get put too many things on your plate
right.
and you don't enjoy it, too many toppings on your pizza and you end up not enjoying it, you think, I should have just had that one, just the pepperoni or the anchovies or something. You put everything on the pizza, you're not going to enjoy it, trust me. So I was like, okay, I need to give myself rules, just like 808s and Heartbreak.
Uh-huh.
Very confined palette of sounds and moods and tempos and references. And when you do that, when you put yourself in a box, all of a sudden you've got to, you know, because you're not just running around using whatever you want, which is the danger of the laptop and a good Wi-Fi connection, is you can conjure up any sound.
Mm-hmm.
But you've got to put yourself in a box. And that's when you get creative.
Discipline.
You know?
But, you know, things have happened since 808 and Heartbreaks. You know, Auto-Tune went under attack.
From Jay. That was the funny thing. We were working on, you know, on his record and 808s and mine all at the same time, and Cuddy's stuff and Sean's stuff, and like having so much fun with Auto-Tune and using it as a, you know, almost like a distortion pedal for a guitarist or whatever. And then Jay does Death of Auto-Tune.
Yeah.
And it's like, excuse me.
I'm still here.
But he was funny, you know, go shoot a viral. I mean, that was a funny track.
Yeah, that was great. And also, to your point, I feel like part of your signature is the big intros to me. Like, a lot of the songs you have these grand intros and these setups.
Yeah, man.
Is that going to be true to this album?
I don't know. I think this is going to be like a relatively quiet record. You're going to be surprised at how kind of close to the point of being claustrophobic that the sound is.
Okay.
Almost like, you know, I'm known for those high kind of heroic vocals. This is the opposite. This is me like kind of like today, just like, hey, mm-hmm. I've got some lyrics for you. Which I hope is kind of on trend in this sort of post Billie Eilish world of just sort of, you know, here's the chorus. Chorus.
Let's take a listen.
Yes.
To Antidote. And this song is about
rewind.
Set it up. Set the song up.
Give us context.
Oh.
Yeah.
I mean, this is the best example on the record of that claustrophobia, mm-hmm. of quiet being the new loud.
I love.
888-742-3345. Give us a call.
You of all people.
You want to talk
after all we've been through,
with Mr. Hudson.
Started out an angel.
Mr. Hudson, ladies and gentlemen. I like that. That song is out now, too, matter of fact. This man has done so much great work, Heather B., whether it's the Jonas Brothers, Joe Jonas, or Janelle Monáe, Jay-Z, Duran, 808 and Heartbreak. I'm curious to having so much success contributing to that particular project, which is a groundbreaking project. Many will say change the sound of music, what I call an era project. How do you not gravitate towards that same formula that won for you so many times in the past moving forward?
You know, celebrating 10 years of 808s and Heartbreak, first of all, it was crazy that time had passed.
Mm-hmm.
Because it kind of feels like 5 minutes ago, yeah. or like last summer. But it definitely reminded me that there was something in that classic formula of like super sad, kind of processed vocals, you know, that kind of, I call it sad robot music, but mm-hmm. with the thump of the 808 and the like industrial drums that we had. And there definitely was a bit of me that thought, you know, last September or whenever it was, everyone was like celebrating 808 so hard. I was like, maybe I should just go and, you know.
Get up on that. Get up on that wave.
Exactly. Yeah. You know, I think something old, something new is always the best combination. Uh-huh. So I'm definitely making this album, wanting to be up to date, make a record for 2020, you know, and I'm listening to like Billie Eilish and stuff, but I'm also thinking, hang on, 808s was pretty useful,
uh-huh.
you know, like for me and everybody, like, why not do some more of that? It's kind of like going back to, you know, I feel like it's very fashionable to say, don't look back,
uh-huh.
you know, but yeah, look back.
Yeah.
Nostalgia's a good thing, but also like learn from the greats and also learn from like your wins.
Yeah.
Not to sound too much like Gary Vee, but like learn from your wins. You should be allowed to revisit things that went well for you. So I thought let me have a little bit of that, but also while staying up to date.
How much were you in the DNA of 808 and Heartbreak? 808s and Heartbreak.
I mean, I was there from the beginning to the end. So
okay. Every know, song.
I did pop out for lunch occasionally, but
yeah.
And then this. Make him laugh on a Monday morning, Mr. Hudson.
Yeah.
The funniest story for me is like we had a lot of people come through. Some people phoned their vocals in. Like, sadly, Lil Wayne didn't visit the studio. I would have loved to have met him, but
oh, wow.
he like sent his vocals in. But most people visited, including this young Canadian dude called Drake.
Yeah.
And I was like, and he came in and they were like, okay, we're gonna do a song for this Drake kid. I was like, cool, nice to meet you. And this is like 2008.
Uh huh.
So I'm like, hey, never met this guy, never heard of him before. Mm-hmm. Seems nice. I was a little jet lagged, so I slept through the whole session.
Oh.
Wow.
I just lay down on the couch, thought, you do your thing, son, I need a break.
And you didn't see any of the magic.
And they wrote, I better find your loving. I better find your heart. I slept through the whole session from beginning to end. Jet lag.
Wow.
Jet lag is real and may affect someone you know.
Okay, thank you for the warning.
Don't sleep.
Wow, you slept through the whole thing.
Yeah, I mean, I was like, you know, like 95% of stuff, I was like, this sounds good, but they don't need me. They got this.
Wow, Tracy G.
Were you
you don't get publishing for sleeping.
You don't get that.
For being in the room and being asleep.
Okay.
Many have tried to claim it, though. Right. I was in the room.
Many have tried to claim without even being in the room.
Yeah, right?
Dang, many have failed as well.
Where there's a hit, there's a writ.
Okay.
You know that? Did you say writ?
Writ. Ten. Uh-huh. It's the core of a writ.
Written, yeah.
You get sued.
Miss Azza, mm-hmm. I'm wondering, I remember how many arguments I had with my guy friends when 808s and Heartbreak came out, where I was defending it.
You were team 808s.
Oh my goodness. It still is my favorite Kanye album. Were you surprised or were you prepared for people to not fully embrace it from jump?
You know, I've always been doing weird stuff myself.
Yeah.
Like the album that Kanye signed me off of was a hybrid album itself. We had a steel pan or a steel drum. Mm-hmm. We had a classical pianist. I was playing acoustic guitar. We had this like reggae bass line going all the time, and we had electronic drums live off pads. So we were a very kind of eclectic. We didn't make sense. So then I was flown in to make an album that didn't make sense to a lot of people as well. But that's where the interesting stuff happens.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, I like the wisdom. If you're not on the edge, you're taking up too much room.
Mm.
Like, get out. Bowie said, go out, into the water, and it's not till your toes are barely touching the ocean floor. Thank you. Sorry. That's when you're going to do your interesting work, when you're kind of slightly not sure of what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
Anyone can sit on the beach and eat a sandwich. You know, it's like, if I don't do that, you get sand in a sandwich. That is not a good situation.
Yeah,
but, anyone can chill in the shallows, but you got to go out to the uncharted territory and do something interesting. And I will always applaud Kanye for doing that with 808s, mm-hmm. you know, and before and since, saying, we're not just going to, like, you know, load up a boom black beat and just... He always wants to break new ground lyrically and sonically and work with new artists. And we didn't really know what we were doing. I mean, we knew what we were doing technically, but I mean, we didn't know necessarily what the result was going to be of what we were creating. Maybe he did, but he.
What about creating? I mean, you slept on Drake. What about Kid Cudi, though? Kid Cudi to me is part of the genius fabric.
Absolutely.
That just ushered in a whole new era of sound and songwriting and expression and vulnerability, which you're speaking about right now.
Yeah.
What was that process like working with him? What did you notice?
I mean, he's a character. I noticed his sort of, he was immediately very, very open with me, very much like heart on his sleeve.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that the interesting thing is working on that album together, it gave us all permission as dudes who don't traditionally, necessarily share a lot of their emotions, like a bunch of guys together, we were all like opening up about stuff,
mm-hmm.
And Kid Cudi was talking to me about his past and growing up and his story and his struggles, and but in a positive way of like, this is why I'm motivated.
Mike Muse.
Yeah, you're a great storyteller. Just listening to you tell the story is absolutely amazing.
It's this coffee. It's just got me going.
It's starting to kick in. It's American coffee, by the way.
The problem is I talk too much. I'm not letting you guys speak.
That's perfect, though. Listen to the story about you being in Hawaii and feeling, not having the confidence to go and to contribute to the project that was happening because you have never done hip-hop before. What song did it all click for you where you can say, you know what, I'm confident, I'm comfortable, I can be a producer within the hip-hop genre? Was there a song or a moment?
Well, the funny thing is with 808s, I was there primarily as a writer and a singer, although I did accidentally end up producing, but I don't think that's the reason I got on the plane. So that was definitely a confidence boost to do all three of those things. I didn't know why I was going to Hawaii, but I came away from it, looking back now, I was like, oh, so I produced, wrote, and sang on a Kanye West album. That's pretty cool. And then it led to working on other records with him and Jay and Cudi and Sean and Future and Janelle Monáe and,
Ooh, damn, he just listed it. Yeah. Ow, okay.
Ouch.
Wow. Shit, let it breathe. Let it breathe. Don't even say nothing. Just let it breathe.
You reintroduce to yourself, Mr.
There you go. There you go.
I forget what I've done, and then people ask me, and I'm like, oh, yeah,
Yeah.
I don't want to sound like my own Wikipedia entry, but you don't know what you're doing until you've done it. Listen, I just take every session, every opportunity to write and record, mm-hmm. almost the same way, like make a strong pot of coffee, plug all the stuff in, hit the red button, see what happens.
Mm. Yes. Mr. Hudson, Heather B.
Do you have any studio rituals? Are you able to sleep the night before knowing you're going in with somebody huge? Do you have red candles? Like, what, any rituals in the studio?
You know, I like to tidy up.
Mm.
I think, you know, it's like when you're cooking. Would you rather cook in a messy kitchen or an immaculate, clean, organized kitchen?
Clean, organized.
And do you think the food would be actually end up being tastier and better presented if the kitchen was like ready to go?
Mm-hmm.
You speak to a lot of like, particularly the mix engineers and producers. Like, you ask them for their one bit of advice. They're like, tidy your studio, tidy your session. You know,
yeah.
Be prepared. Kind of, and you talk to people in other areas about their success. Like, why is, you know, LeBron the best, or why is Kobe the best, why is Jordan? And their people always say, yeah, he kind of trained harder than anyone else.
Yeah,
he right. was shooting threes until 4 a.m, or, you know, he was training for 3 hours before the training session and 3 hours afterwards. And you do your work in private, you prepare, and then you make it look easy.
Yeah.
Mm.
So if you're a singer, warm up before the session, just in the Uber, just, you know, or whatever, or the, you know, the yellow taxi cab or the Lyft, or the, you know, you can cycle, you can walk. just do some vocal warm-ups.
Yeah.
Don't be hungover. I used to go into sessions like hungover and not prepared, and it's actually more fun if you're prepared. Picasso said he had his best ideas when he was sweeping the studio. Don't delegate all of those tasks away. You don't have to have an intern to go and get you a coffee, sushi, or tidy your cables, or do your file management. Do that stuff yourself. Have respect for the whole process. And like Picasso, you will have your, funnily enough, you will have your best ideas while you're walking to the store to get your own stuff, your True. Own chips and dips. On the way back, you'll have a clarity of what you need to do creatively in the next move. If you're just at the computer, like, I'm the man, I don't do anything but make beats or whatever, you're actually just gonna get stuck.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so that's my process, is like, love the whole process.
Yeah.
Love the whole process.
And you know, I love audio. I love looking at it in the computer. People are like, why are you doing that by hand? There's a shortcut, blah, blah, blah. Like, I want to get to know my audio. I recognize my hi-hats, like my kids, you know, I can see it on the screen. Oh, that's the wrong one. Fush, fush.
Yeah.
You know, I know how to chop them, stretch them, shape them, because you got to love the whole process.
Mm-hmm.
Tidy your studio.
Mr. Hudson. Tidy your studio means so many different
that
things
so
on so many different levels.
It's so lame. It kind of sounds so lame when I boil it down.
Oh, that's gems right there.
You know?
When the Machine Stops, his first new album in 10 years, ladies and gentlemen, coming out June the 21st. I want to thank you for coming by, man.
Thank you, man.
I've been hoping we can do this, bro. And I can see we need parts 2, 3, and 4. Okay?
You know, you just press play and I'll go.
You'll go? All right. Well, you know, you got this song. I'm going to end with the song Chicago, featuring a good friend of ours, a citizen of Sway in the Morning, Vic Mensa. The song is called Chicago, so I imagine that's why Vic's on it.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
This is kind of an exclusive, I think.
Yeah, well, you know, that's what we do.
Only here. The best.
Yes, yes, yes. I got it out of your phone when you weren't looking. As you was telling that great story, I was snagging the file. And set it up for us.
Man, Vic's great. We've done a few tracks together, and funnily enough, the universe brings people together in different ways. We actually kind of live in the same neighborhood, so it's literally like, it's like kids. So you go around on your BMX and make some music. It feels really chill. I feel like I could go and knock on his door and be like, hey, I've got a track for you.
Nice.
And that's great. It's nice when you get like beyond just being, you know, having to book the session through your management, mm-hmm. your publisher, feeling like you can just text someone and be like, what are you doing?
Right.
I'm bored. Let's make some legendary music.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I just went round. He cut his verse and like, he did it himself. Like, he's just like, doesn't slow himself down by having an engineer. He's just just grabs the mic. Let me do this. And yeah, he just like pretty much off the top of the dome. Just
really.
Yeah, he's quick.
Yeah, that's Vic Mensa, man. Powerful guy, man. Really powerful
guy. He's an artist, and you know, obviously, like, I met him as a rapper back in the day in London, actually, thanks to DJ Semtex. Was like, you need to meet Vic Mensa. I was like, Vic who? And I met him and DJ Oreo, and we had some food, and then we went to this show. You know Oreo,
yeah,
good dude.
Good dude.
And we went to, I think, a Kanye show backstage, and I'm like, you've met Kanye, right? Because you're from Chicago. You guys must have chopped it up at some point. He's like, No, I haven't. This is like 5 years ago or something.
So you introduced Vic to Kanye?
So I said, Kanye, come over here. This is Vic. You guys need to meet. You're both from Chicago, right? So they met, and, you know, Ye always loves meeting new people, new creatives, particularly, you know, guys from Chicago. And I think a few months later, they had You Mad.
Uh-huh.
So
yeah, wow!
I should have slept through that session.
Damn, I mean, shit, man! Look at this guy, Mr. Hudson, bringing Chicago legends together.
That's what it's all about, yeah. You know. It's all about people. Uh-huh. You know, just some more like mom advice. Mm-hmm. It's all about people, and particularly now with the tech, anyone can sit down, make a beat. Anyone can like go and buy a mic, plug it in. But it really comes down to people.
Comes down to people. Mr. Hudson, don't forget to get the album When the Machine Stops, June 21st. Antidote is out now.
Amazing.
This song we're going to play first, but it's out this Friday. It's called Chicago, featuring Vic Mensa. We'll do some Celebrity Wire up next, but I want to thank you for coming by.
Appreciate
the show,
you,
man.
Thanks all for right? having me.
Continue success, bro.
Thank you.
All right, here it is. Sway in the Morning.